Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Tales of Two Americas, Stories of Inequality in a Divided Nation. Edited by John Freeman. Narrated by Corey M. Snow and Teri Schnaubelt. Introduction. John Freeman. Last winter, I flew home to Sacramento for a short visit. On a mild December night, I slipped on a coat and set out walking from the Capitol to a bookstore not far away. Very quickly, as in most American cities, I was approached and asked for money. Each man, and they were all men, spoke a reason. Spare some change for the holidays? A dollar for a veteran? Do you have any money for food? Taken in isolation, their requests had a stark, brutal simplicity. They were each a call to basic kindness. Will you see me? Will you help? Of course, even the most strapped of us has a quarter for a hungry person. So I gave. I always do. I know it is quite possible the reasons were ploys to get money for other things, but I cannot stand the other possibility, which is that the need was actual and dire. I walked on after speaking to the last man and approached my destination in a state of dismay and déjà vu. I had been traveling a lot that fall and winter, and everywhere I went, I saw an unkind America. It was a constant refrain in Chicago, in Seattle, in Portland, in Miami. Got some change? Can you help? Got some money for a veteran? Most people walk right by. Somewhat understandably. The only way in which to reside or work in much of America for many is to ignore these requests, in essence, to deny our mutual humanity in order to live our lives. My dismay had another source, however. I had actually traveled to Sacramento that December to have an event at Time-Tested Books to discuss this very issue of homelessness and inequality in New York. I had just published an anthology called Tales of Two Cities, The Best of Times and Worst of Times in Today's New York, and I decided to walk because some of the most important essays in that book came from walkers, from people who saw New York at a human pace, and so saw the stories it was not telling itself. I thought about it and realized that most of my memories of Sacramento were seen at the speed of a car. I couldn't remember a single walk I had taken with my grandfather, who moved to the city in 1933 and helped build the church we attended, or my father, who was born 6 years later and grew up downtown, or my brothers, who moved with me to the suburbs of Sacramento from Pennsylvania in 1984. We drove, parked, and walked a short distance to our destination. Now, 30 years later, I was on foot and seeing a very different city, wondering if I had been passing by it all along or if something important had changed. As I approached 21st Street, I began to despair that I had come to Sacramento to speak about New York. That's when another man dressed in jeans and a work shirt stepped into my path, looking like he might be needing directions. He did. "Do you know where the Meals on Wheels truck is, man?" he asked. America is broken. You don't need a fistful of statistics to know this. You just need eyes and ears and stories. Walk around any American city, and evidence of the shattered compact with citizens will present itself. There you will see broken roads, overloaded schools, police forces on edge, clusters, and sometimes whole tent cities of homeless people camped in eyeshot of shopping districts that are beginning to resemble ramparts of wealth rather than stores for all. Thick glass windows and security guards stand between aspirational goods and the people outside in Portland, Oregon, in San Francisco, in Seattle, Los Angeles, New York, and Miami. The soaring cost of living in these cities, which have become meccas for luxury and creative economy work, but depend on service labor to run their dream machines, has a lot to do with this state of affairs. Adjusting for rent and costs, the middle-class residents of these cities now have the lowest real earnings of any metropolitan area. And across the nation at large, America's top 10% earns 9 times as much as the bottom 90%. This is not just an urban problem. In smaller cities and towns, and in rural America, the gulf between the haves and have-nots stretches just as wide, even if its symptoms are not so visible. California might be home to more than 100 billionaires whose collected assets dwarf the GDP of most nations in the world, but nearly a quarter of the state is poor. The jobs that were once done by hand are increasingly done by machine. Appalachia, upstate New York, Michigan, inequality stretches to almost unthinkable gulfs there, too. No matter how much one hears of recovery and new jobs, what those jobs are and what they promise tend to get left out. These jobs are often short shift work, work without benefits, work so temporary it has created a new term, the precariat. This unease became the pivot point of the 2016 presidential election. Financial inequality is not just a symptom of bad public policy, though, or something that has emerged only in tandem with the forces of the recent election. It was formed by decades of injustice and structural inequality in America, produced by the nation's growth on the back of stolen labor, the failure of Reconstruction, the entrenchment of racial bias in the culture, restrictions on immigration and the way immigration law is enforced, the long aftermath of the war on drugs, sexism, gender imbalances, and the complicity of financial services in preying upon those afflicted by these inequalities with predatory lending. We also haven't introduced meaningful progressive taxation in decades. Whatever benefits the once robust welfare state ensured have been all but demolished by this deeply enmeshed system of inequality, putting far more at risk than just upward mobility. It has put people's bodies at risk. Writing in the wake of a lethal police shooting in Charlotte earlier last year, the pastor William Barber II noted, "When Charlotte's poor black neighborhoods were afflicted with disproportionate law enforcement during the war on drugs, condemning a whole generation to bad credit and a lack of job opportunities, our elected representatives didn't call it violence. When immigration officers raid homes and snatch undocumented children from bus stops, they don't call it violence. But all of these policies and practices do violence to the lives of thousands of Charlotte residents." The way systems of oppression have entrenched themselves in the United States calls out for a new framework for writing about inequality. We need to look beyond statistics and numbers and wage rates. We need to create a framework that accounts for what it feels like to live in this America, a framework that can give space to the stories that reveal how many forces outside of wages lead to income inequality, which is a symptom of a network of inequalities. The work of writing has been done for decades by writers who do not have a choice but to pay attention to these forces. This anthology is an attempt to bring together the best of these writers and recast the story of America in their words. Piece by piece, you will watch as these writers demolish the myth of Horatio Alger and replace it with the reality of what it feels like to try to keep a foothold in America today. In a poignant essay, Manuel Munoz pays tribute to his dying father, who came north from Central America to pick lettuce and cotton, jobs that are all but vanishing as work that can sustain a family. The U.S. Poet Laureate Juan Felipe Herrera contributes a short poem that salutes the unnamed and undocumented workers who still try. Very often, what is left behind isn't in the past at all. In her short story, Dosas, Edwidge Danticat conjures a home health aide whose ex-boyfriend returns with a request for money because his new wife has been kidnapped back home in Haiti. The problems of America are indeed not just based in the United States, but they follow populations here and take root in this landscape. The poet Lawrence Joseph writes of the tectonic tension global forces brought to bear on Detroit, the city demolished by fleeing manufacturing industries that have shipped jobs overseas. Timothy Egan remembers the days when you could find such work to sustain you in Seattle. That is no longer the case. The novelist Richard Russo muses on what a blow it is to a person's dignity when their work is taken away, how that destroys a part of their soul. So what do you do? Sarah Smarsh's brother, like many thousands of Americans, sells his blood plasma to the growing global industry of plasma sales in Kansas. In R.S. DeRen's short story, two men in Michigan mow lawns of recently repossessed homes. They do not lack for work. Jess Rulofson describes veterans returning to the lower plains from Iraq to precarious employment. This does not, of course, stop new families from coming to the United States. There is just a much steeper ladder for coming out of poverty. And also, a crisis of identity of what America is and who counts as citizens. In her short story, Rue Freeman brings to life housekeepers and nannies who live in the orbit of families but get very little of the benefits. In her essay, Patricia Engel describes how an influx of labor in these industries from Cuba, the Caribbean, Mexico, and elsewhere call Miami home now, as whites in the same city redefine their notion of home in terms of racial purity and exclusion. Rebecca Solnit's devastating account of a shooting in San Francisco describes how the incident came as a direct result of the encroaching gentrification of the victim's neighborhood. The people who called the police on the day of the victim's death would have known him had they lived in the area for years, as so many residents around them did. Too often, the police are in an adversarial relationship with people they are meant to protect. In her powerful poem, American Arithmetic, Natalie Diaz meditates on the fact that while Native Americans make up less than 1% of the population, they are killed at an alarming rate. When we are dying, she writes, who should we call? In Keith Lehman's potent essay, he recalls a friend who was arrested in his college town for allegedly doing what so many of its students do, selling drugs. Only, in his friend's case, since he wasn't a student, the law was far swifter and more severe. The deterioration of this relationship between police and Americans of color has created a sense that there are two Americas, one black, one blue, and the dream that America tells itself is possible feels not like a dream, but like a lie, something the poet Denez Smith circles in his beautiful poem. It's been this way for a long time. Kevin Young's poem on Howlin' Wolf reminds, something that demands a song of protest. How are white Americans to situate themselves before this blunt fact? How do they acknowledge it while also respecting that it is far easier for them to protest than their brothers and sisters who pay far more dearly for their voices? In Joyce Carol Oates' story, Leander, an older white woman visits an African-American church that hosts a Black Lives Matter-type protest and finds herself feeling like an intruder. All of her instincts lead to self-consciousness. In her essay, Eula Biss changes the concept from white guilt to white debt, a far more useful idea in the face of the economic benefits of being white. Brad Watson learned these lessons early growing up in Mississippi, when his mother hired a woman of color to be their housekeeper for a daily wage that was less than he made in a few hours mowing lawns. Education has so long been held aloft as the way that America can correct the systemic imbalances of its history and culture. Several pieces here explore the loopholes in that equation. Kirsten Valdez-Quaid remembers working as a counselor at an elite prep school summer program where a Hispanic student from a lower-income background flunked out due to the lack of support the program gave her, even as that program coveted the girl's diversity. Quaid makes a powerful argument for why schools that run such programs made to enhance diversity in their student body need to do more for their enrollees upon their arrival. No such programs existed when Dagoberto Gil was growing up in Los Angeles and Texas. He had to make the possibility for himself, and in his memoir describes the agonies and leave-takings such a discovery entailed. In Nami Moon's short story, two parents who have sacrificed everything for their child to have opportunities they never did pay the ultimate price when their debt comes crashing down on them. One of the powerful sensations that arises from these pieces concerns the ethics of our times. How can some of us live when we know others are not experiencing the same comfort? In Hector Tobar's memoir, he recalls reporting on a gang shooting casualty, a young boy his son's age, in a neighborhood adjacent to his own in Los Angeles. Meanwhile, over in Idaho, Anthony Doerr returns home to his house, tired from a day with his children, and discovers a man parked in his driveway, possibly asleep in his car. Who is this man, he wonders, and what has led him to a remote cul-de-sac near Boise? Is he simply tired, or out of steam in an existential sense? Where the stress falls and where it does not can feel, in a culture that has so eagerly ripped out certain social nets, almost cruelly random. In Joy Williams's story, a man prepares to dismantle the estate of a wealthy politician in Maine, his house and liquor stocks suddenly, without the late man's presence, highlighting the absurdity of accumulation for its own sake. There is a lurking feeling of estrangement in America. Of people from their lives, of Americans from one another, of all of us from places as they race to change. In his poem, Visible City, Ricky Laurentis wishes he could make all the cities within his city of New Orleans more visible. Larry Watson bemoans the loss of the Bismarck, North Dakota that he called home once, where the well-to-do and the middle classes lived on the same block, and the cathedrals of accumulation one sees now circling the city were unthinkable. Chris Offutt bemoans such changes too, but he isn't about to become a spokesman for the working classes by selling his heritage back to well-to-do buyers in the form of essays on trash food, as one editor asks him to write. What is required to make it in America often requires leaving home and grappling with a new place. In her barbed and lovely essay on Chicago, Sandra Cisneros remembers how the city that raised her also trained her to leave it in order to survive, to become herself. A far greater threat to personhood lurks in Wait for the Women in Roxane Gay's short story. Raised by an abusive, out-of-work drunk, married to husbands who don't pull their weight, they sense their time to escape is running out. Claire V. Watkins remembers the many houses and trailers she grew up in across the West, and how she and her sister kept eyes on each other as their mother spiraled close to giving up. I hope there is a bandwidth of care that still exists in America, one where people don't give a hand just because it suits them, but because it is the right thing to do. It is how we all get by. Annie Dillard recommends this to writers on days when they wonder what they are for. Whitney Terrell practiced this generosity with a next-door neighbor and realized what a complicated network of expectations he was entering. In her essay, Ann Patchett recalls a priest in Nashville who lived by this credo and all the good work he did. And in Portland, Oregon, today, Karen Russell describes a city with a homeless problem so large, an epidemic of generosity among all its citizens might be the only way out. It might sound trite, the notion that the solution to our problems in America lies between us, not above us, and not in the governments that have let us down. Perhaps, but all one has to do is get stuck overnight in an airport, as Julia Alvarez did on her way home to Vermont one night, to realize that the thin boundaries between people can easily be broken down by one shared experience. Alvarez watches as people of all colors and backgrounds help one another find places to sleep, blankets to wrap themselves in, food to eat. In America today, we have come to view inequality as a problem that afflicts only the needy. What a mistake! For it is in sharing that we can alleviate a situation that pains us all. I do have one memory of Sacramento that came to mind not long after I left behind the man looking for the Meals on Wheels truck. Christmas 1986. In those years, my father worked as a director of a family service nonprofit that created drug and alcohol recovery programs, Meals on Wheels trucks for seniors, counseling for families who could not afford it otherwise. That year, he decided it was a good idea to take us around South Sacramento giving out toys and turkeys to families who could not afford them. And so we piled into our station wagon with a trunk full of food and presents. I was used to knocking on doors back then. I had a paper route, and every month I had to ride a few miles around my suburban neighborhood chasing down the $8.50 it cost for home delivery of the Sacramento Bee. Most people paid. No one ever invited me in, and a few people dodged me. That latter group made me wonder, who doesn't pay an 11-year-old who has been riding to your doorstep at 5:30 every morning? And there were different sorts of houses, like the ones we visited that Christmas. The screen doors open even in winter. The dogs did not look particularly friendly, but the people were. That holiday, as we drove from house to house, we were invited in, welcomed, hugged, and even when people felt uncomfortable, one teenager our age ran off crying, we shared a few words. My father stood in living rooms and asked where people were from. My parents never told me what this trip was supposed to mean. It was clear. Arriving back at our home felt surreal. There was no cosmological reason why my brothers and I were allowed to grow up there rather than in one of the homes we just left. Improbability demands stories. Each one of us in America could have grown up someone else had the universe's mysterious finger touched a different key. Later in life, when both of my brothers were briefly homeless at separate times, I discovered how even with comfortable upbringings, the ladder of society can slip from right beneath you. Back then, I didn't have the stories I needed to know this was possible. I just had this one trip. I was lucky.
Death by gentrification. The killing of Alex Nieto and the savaging of San Francisco. Rebecca Solnit. On what would have been his 30th birthday, Alejandro Nieto's parents left a packed courtroom in San Francisco shortly before pictures from their son's autopsy were shown to a jury. The photograph showed what happens when 14 bullets rip through a person's head and body. Refugio and Elvira Nieto spent much of the rest of the day sitting on a bench in the windowless hall of the federal building, where their civil lawsuit for their son's wrongful death was being heard. Alex Nieto was 28 years old when he was killed in the neighborhood where he had spent his whole life. He died in a barrage of bullets fired at him by four San Francisco policemen. There are a few things about his death that everyone agrees on. He was in a hilltop park eating a burrito and tortilla chips, wearing the taser he owned for his job as a licensed security guard at a nightclub, when someone called 911 on him a little after 7 p.m., on the evening of March 21st, 2014. The police officers who arrived a few minutes later claim that Nieto defiantly pointed the taser at them and that they mistook its red laser light for the laser sights of a gun and shot him in self-defense. However, the stories of the four officers contradict one another's and some of the evidence. On the road that curves around the green hilltop of Bernal Heights Park, is an unofficial memorial to Nieto. People walking dogs or running or taking a stroll stop to read the banner, which is pinned by stones to the slope of the hill and surrounded by fresh and artificial flowers. Alex's father, Refugio, still visits the memorial at least once a day, walking up from his small apartment on the south side of Bernal Hill. Alex Nieto had been visiting the hilltop since he was a child. That evening, his parents, joined by friends and supporters, went up there in the dark to bring a birthday cake to the memorial. Refugio and Elvira Nieto are dignified, modest people, straight-backed but careworn, who speak eloquently in Spanish and hardly at all in English. They had known each other as poor children in a little town in the state of Guanajuato in central Mexico and emigrated separately to the Bay Area in the 1970s. There, they met again and married in 1984. They have lived in the same building on the south slope of Bernal Hill ever since. She worked for decades as a housekeeper in San Francisco's downtown hotels and is now retired. He had worked on the side, but mostly stayed at home as the principal caregiver of Alex and his younger brother Hector. In the courtroom, Hector, handsome, somber, with glossy black hair pulled back neatly, sat with his parents most days, not far from the three white and one Asian policemen who killed his brother. That there was a trial at all was a triumph. The city had withheld from family and supporters the full autopsy report and the names of the officers who shot Nieto, and it was months before the key witness overcame his fear of the police to come forward. Nieto died because a series of white men saw him as a menacing intruder in the place he had spent his whole life. Some of them thought he was possibly a gang member because he was wearing a red jacket. Many Latino boys and men in San Francisco avoid wearing red and blue because they are the colors of two gangs, the Norteños and Sureños. But the colors of San Francisco's football team, the 49ers, are red and gold. Wearing a 49ers jacket in San Francisco is as ordinary as wearing a Saints jersey in New Orleans. That evening, Nieto, who had thick black eyebrows and a closely cropped goatee, was wearing a new-looking 49ers jacket, a black 49ers cap, a white t-shirt, black trousers, and carried the taser in a holster on his belt, under his jacket. A taser shoots out wires that delivers an electrical shock, briefly paralyzing its target. It is shaped roughly like a gun, but more bulbous. Nieto's had bright yellow markings over much of its surface and a 15-foot range. Nieto had first been licensed by the state as a security guard in 2007 and had worked in that field since. He had never been arrested and had no police record, an achievement in a neighborhood where Latino kids can get picked up just for hanging out in public. He was a Buddhist. A Latino son of immigrants who practiced Buddhism is the kind of hybrid San Francisco used to be good at. As a teen, he had worked as a youth counselor for almost 5 years at the Bernal Heights Neighborhood Center. He was gregarious and community-spirited, a participant in political campaigns, street fairs, and community events. He had graduated from community college with a focus on criminal justice and hoped to help young people as a probation officer. He had an internship with the city's juvenile probation department not long before his death, according to former city probation officer Carlos Gonzalez, who became a friend. Gonzalez said Nieto knew how criminal justice worked in the city. No one has ever provided a convincing motive for why he would point a gun-shaped object at the police when he understood that it would probably be a fatal act. Like a rape victim, the dead young man underwent character assassination, as irrelevant but unflattering things were dredged up about his past and publicized. Immediately after his death, the police and coroner's office dug into his medical records and found that he'd had a mental health crisis years before. They blew that up into a story that he was mentally ill and made that an explanation for what happened. It ran like this. Why did they shoot Nieto? Because he pointed his taser at them and they thought it was a gun. Why did he point his taser at them? Because he was mentally ill. Why should we believe he was mentally ill? Because he pointed his taser at them. It's a circular logic that leads somewhere only if your trust in the San Francisco Police Department is great. Nieto carried a taser for his guard job at the El Toro nightclub, whose owner, Jorge Del Rio, speaks of him as a calm and peaceful person he liked, trusted, admired, and still cares about. He was very calm, a very calm guy, so I was very surprised to hear that they claimed that he pulled a taser on the police. Never have seen him react aggressively to anyone. He was the guy who would want to help others. I just can't believe they're saying this about him. He told me how peaceful Nieto was, how brilliant at diffusing potentially volatile situations, drawing drunk men out of the rowdy dance club with a Spanish-speaking clientele to tell them on the street, "Tonight's not your night," and send them home feeling liked and respected. From the beginning, the police were hoping that Alex Nieto's mental health records would somehow exonerate them. The justification that he was mentally ill got ground, and it got some traction in local publications committed to justifying the police. But it was ruled inadmissible evidence by the judge in the civil suit brought by his parents, Refugio and Alvira Nieto. The medical record said that 3 years earlier, Alex Nieto had some sort of breakdown and was treated for it. Various terms were thrown around, psychosis, paranoid schizophrenia, but the entire file was from 2011, and there seemed to be no major precedents or subsequent episodes of note. The theory that mental illness is relevant presumes not only that he was mentally ill on March 21st, 2014, but that mental illness caused him to point a taser at the police. If you don't believe he pointed a taser at the police, then mental illness doesn't supply any clues to what happened. Did he? The only outside witness to the shooting says he did not. Here's the backstory as I heard it from a family friend. Devastated by a breakup, Alex got very dramatic about it one day, burned some love letters, and was otherwise over the top in the tiny apartment the four Nietos shared. His exasperated family called a city hotline for help in de-escalating, but instead got escalation. Nieto was seized and institutionalized against his will. The official record described burning the letters as burning a book or trying to burn down the house. Something might have gotten lost in translation from Spanish. That was early in 2011. There was another incident later that year. In 2012, 2013, and until his death in 2014, there appear to have been no problems. There is no reason to believe that, even if what transpired in 2011 should be classified as mental illness, he suddenly relapsed on the evening of his death, after years of being exceptionally calm in the chaos of his nightclub job. And shortly before his encounter with the police, he exercised restraint in a confrontation with an aggressor. On the evening of March 21st, 2014, Evan Snow, a 30-something user experience design professional, according to his LinkedIn profile, who had moved to the neighborhood about 6 months earlier and who has since departed for a more suburban location, took his young Siberian husky for a walk on Bernal Hill. As Snow was leaving the park, Nieto was coming up from one of the little dirt trails that leads to the park's ring road, eating chips. In a deposition prior to the trial, Snow said that with his knowledge of the attire of gang members, he put Nieto in that category of people that I would not mess around with. His dog put Nieto in the category of people carrying food and went after him. Snow never seemed to recognize that his out-of-control dog was the aggressor. So Luna was, I think, looking to move around the benches or behind me to run up happily to get a chip from Mr. Nieto. Mr. Nieto became further, what's the right word? Distressed, moving very quickly and rapidly left to right, trying to keep his chips away from Luna. He ran down to these benches and jumped up on the benches, my dog following. She was at that point vocalizing, barking or kind of howling. The dog had Nieto cornered on the bench while its inattentive owner was 40 feet away. In his deposition for the case, under oath, his exact words were that he was distracted by a female jogger's butt. Snow said, I can imagine that somebody could assume the dog was being aggressive at that point. The dog did not come when he called, but kept barking. Nieto, Snow says, then pulled back his jacket and took his taser out, briefly pointing at the distant dog owner before he pointed it at the dog, bang at his feet. The two men yelled at each other, and Snow apparently used a racial slur, but would not later give the precise word. As he left the park, he texted a friend about the incident. His text, according to his testimony, said, In another state like Florida, I would have been justified in shooting Mr. Nieto that night. A reference to that state's infamous Stand Your Ground law, which removes the obligation to retreat before using force in self-defense. In other words, he apparently wished he could have done what George Zimmerman did to Trayvon Martin, execute him without consequences. Soon after, a couple out walking their dogs passed by Nieto. Tim Isgett, a recent arrival in the area, is the communications director of a nonprofit organization founded by tech billionaires. He now lives in suburban Marin County, as does his husband, Justin Fritz, a self-described email marketing manager who had lived in San Francisco about a year. In a picture one of them posted on social media, they are chestnut-haired, clean-cut white men posing with their dogs, a Springer Spaniel and an old bulldog. They were walking those dogs when they passed Nieto at a distance. Fritz did not notice anything unusual, but Isgett saw Nieto moving nervously and putting his hand on the taser in his holsters. Snow was gone, so Izgat had no idea that Nieto had just had an ugly altercation and had reason to be disturbed. Izgat began telling people he encountered to avoid the area. One witness who did see Nieto shortly after Izgat and Fritz, longtime Bernal Heights resident Robin Bullard, who was walking his own dog in the park, testified that there was nothing alarming about him. "He was just sitting there," Bullard said. At the trial, Fritz testified that he had not seen anything alarming about Nieto. He said that he called 911 because Izgat urged him to. At about 7:11 p.m., he began talking to the 911 dispatcher, telling her that there was a man with a black handgun. "What race?" asked the dispatcher. "Black? Hispanic?" "Hispanic," replied Fritz. Later, the dispatcher asked him if the man in question was doing anything violent, and Fritz answered, "Just pacing. It looks like he might be eating chips or sunflowers, but he's resting a hand kind of on the gun." Alex Nieto had about 5 more minutes to live. San Francisco, like all cities, has been a place where, when newcomers arrive in a trickle, they integrate and contribute to the ongoing transformation of a place that is not static in demographics and industries. When they arrive in a flood, as they have during economic booms since the 19th century gold rush, including the dot-com surge of the late 1990s and the current tech tsunami, they scour out what was there before. By 2012, the incursion of tech workers had gone from steady stream to deluge, and more people and institutions, bookstores, churches, social services, nonprofits of all kinds, gay and lesbian bars, small businesses with deep roots in the neighborhoods, began to be evicted. So did seniors, including many in their 90s, school teachers, working class families, the disabled, and pretty much anyone who was a tenant whose home could be milked for more money. San Francisco had been a place where some people came out of idealism or stayed to realize an ideal, to work for social justice or teach the disabled, to write poetry or practice alternative medicine, to be part of something larger than themselves that was not a corporation, to live for something more than money. That was becoming less and less possible as rent and sale prices for homes spiraled upward. What the old-timers were afraid of losing, many of the newcomers seemed unable to recognize. The tech culture seemed, in small and large ways, to be a culture of disconnection and withdrawal. And it was very white, male, and young, which is why I started to call my hometown Fratistan. As of 2014, Google's Silicon Valley employees, for example, were 2% Black, 3% Latino, and 70% male. The Google bus, the private luxury shuttles, made it convenient for these employees who worked in the South Bay to live in San Francisco, as did shuttles for Facebook, Apple, Yahoo, and other big corporations. Airbnb, headquartered in San Francisco, became the engine that devoured long-term housing stock in rural and urban places around the world, turning it into spaces for transients. Uber, also based here, set about undermining taxi companies that paid a living wage. Another tech company housed here, Twitter, became the most efficient way to deliver rape and death threats to outspoken feminists. San Francisco, once a utopia in the eyes of many, became the nerve center of a new dystopia. Tech companies created multimillionaires and billionaires whose influence warped local politics, pushing for policies that served the new industry and their employees at the expense of the rest of the population. None of the money sloshing around the city trickled down to preserve the Center for Homeless Youth that closed in 2013, or the oldest Black-owned, Black-focused bookstore in the country, which closed in 2014, or San Francisco's last lesbian bar, which folded in 2015, or the Latino drag and trans bar that closed the year before. As the Nieto trial unfolded, the uniquely San Francisco African Orthodox Church of St. John Coltrane faced eviction from the home it found after an earlier eviction during the late 1990s dot-com boom. Resentments rose, and cultures clashed. At 7:12 p.m. on the evening of March 21, 2014, the police dispatcher who had spoken to Fritz put out a call. Some police officers began establishing a periphery, a standard way to de-escalate a potentially dangerous situation. One police car shot through the periphery to create a confrontation. In it were Lieutenant Jason Sawyer and Officer Richard Schiff, a rookie who had been on the job for less than 3 months. They headed for Bernal Heights Park when they got the call. Tried first to enter it in their patrol car from the south side, the side where Alex's parents lived, then turned around and drove in from the north side, going around the barrier that keeps vehicles out, and headed up the road that is often full of runners, walkers, and dogs at that time of day. They moved rapidly, but without lights or sirens. They were not heading into an emergency. But they were rushing past their fellow officers and the periphery without coordinating a plan. At 7:17:40 p.m., Alejandro Nieto came walking downhill around a bend in the road, according to the 911 operator's conversation with Fritz. At 7:18:08 p.m., another policeman in the park, but not at the scene, broadcast, "Got a guy in a red shirt coming toward you." Schiff testified in court, "Red could be related to a gang involvement. Red is a Norteño color." Schiff testified that from about 90 feet away, he shouted, "Show me your hands," and that Nieto had replied, "No, show me your hands." Then drew his taser, assuming a fighting stance, holding the weapon in both hands, pointed at the police. The officers claimed that the taser projected a red light, which they assumed was the laser sight of a handgun, and feared for their lives. At 7:18:43 p.m., Schiff and Sawyer began barraging Nieto with 40-caliber bullets. At 7:18:55 p.m., Schiff shouted, "Red!" a police code word for out of ammunition. He had emptied a whole clip at Nieto. He reloaded and began shooting again, firing 23 bullets in all. Sawyer was also blazing away. He fired 20 bullets. Their aim appears to have been sloppy because Fritz, who had taken refuge in a grove of eucalyptus trees below the road, can be heard shouting, "Help! Help!" on his call to the 911 operator, as bullets fired by the police were hitting the trees above me, breaking things, and just coming at me. Sawyer said, "Once I realized there was no reaction, none at all, after being shot, I picked up my sights and aimed for the head." Nieto was hit just above the lip by a bullet that shattered his right upper jaw and teeth. Another ripped through both bones of his lower right leg. Though the officers testify that he remained facing them, that latter bullet went into the side of his leg, as though he had turned away. That while so agonizingly injured, he remained focused on pretending to menace the police with a useless device that drew fire to him is hard to believe. Two more officers, Roger Morse and Nate Chu, drove up to the first patrol car, got out, and drew their guns. There was no plan, no communications, no strategy to contain the person they were pursuing or capture him alive if he proved to be a menace, to avoid a potentially dangerous confrontation in a popular park where bystanders could be hit. Morse testified in court, "When I first arrived, I saw what appeared to be muzzle flash. I aimed at him and began shooting." Tasers produce nothing that resembles muzzle flash. Chu, in contrast to his partner officer's account, testified that Nieto was already on the ground when they arrived. He fired 5 shots at the man on the ground. He told the court he stopped when he saw the suspect's head fall down to the pavement. Several more bullets hit Nieto while he was on the ground. At least 14 struck him, according to the city autopsy report. Only 1 out of every 4 of the bullets the officers fired reached their target. They fired 59 in all. They were shooting to kill and to overkill. One went into his left temple and tore through his head toward his neck. Several hit him in the back, chest, and shoulders. One more went into the small of his back, severing his spinal cord. The officers approached Nieto at 7:19:20 p.m., less than 2 minutes after it had all begun. Morse was the first to get there. He says that Nieto's eyes were open and that he was gasping and gurgling. He says that he kicked the taser out of the dying man's hands. Schiff says he handcuffed him, rolled him over, and said, "Sarge, he's got a pulse." By the time the ambulance arrived, Alejandro Nieto was dead. Nieto's funeral, on April 1, 2014, packed the little church in Bernal Heights that his mother had taken him to as a child. I went with my friend, Adriana Camarena, a civic-minded lawyer from Mexico City who lives in the Mission District, the neighborhood on Bernal's north flank that has been a capital of Latino culture since the 1960s. She had met Alex briefly. I never had. We sat near a trio of African-American women who had lost their own sons in police killings and routinely attend the funerals of other such victims. In the months that followed, Adriana became close to Refugio and Elvira Nieto. Their son had been their ambassador to the English-speaking world, and gradually Adriana was drawn into their grief and their need. She stepped in as an interpreter, advocate, counsel, and friend. Benjamin Bach Sierra, a novelist and former Marine who teaches writing at San Francisco's Community College, was a devoted friend and mentor to Alex. He has become the other leader of a small coalition named Justice for Alex Nieto. In that springtime of Nieto's death, I had begun to believe that what was tearing my city apart was not only a conflict pitting long-term tenants against affluent newcomers and the landlords, estate agents, house flippers, and developers seeking to open up room for them by shoving everyone else out. It was a conflict between two different visions of the city. What I felt strongly at the funeral was the vital force of real community, people who experienced where they lived as a fabric woven from memory, ritual and habit, affection and love. This was a measure of place that had nothing to do with money and ownership and everything to do with connection. Adriana and I turned around in our pew and met Oscar Salinas, a big man born and raised in the Mission. He told us that when someone in the community is hurt, the Mission comes together.
We take care of each other.
To him, the Mission meant the people who shared Latino identity and a commitment to a set of values and to one another, all held together by place. It was a beautiful vision that many shared. The sense of community people were trying to hang on to was about the things that money cannot buy. It was about home as a whole neighborhood and the neighbors in it, not just the real estate you held title to or paid rent on. It was not only the treasure of Latinos. White, Black, Asian, and Native American residents of San Francisco had long-term relationships with people, institutions, traditions, particular locations. Disruption has been a favorite word of the new tech economy, but old-timers saw homes, communities, traditions, and relationships being disrupted. Many of the people being evicted and priced out were the people who held us all together. Teachers, nurses, counselors, social workers, carpenters and mechanics, volunteers and activists. When, for example, someone who worked with gang kids got driven out, those kids were abandoned. How many threads could you pull out before the social fabric disintegrated? 2 months before the funeral, the real estate website Redfin looked at the statistics and concluded that 83% of California's homes and 100% of San Francisco's were unaffordable on a teacher's salary. What happens to a place when the most vital workers cannot afford to live in it? Displacement has contributed to deaths, particularly of the elderly, and many in their 80s and 90s have been targeted with eviction from their homes of many decades. In the 2 years since Nieto's death, there have been multiple stories of seniors who died during or immediately after their eviction. A survey reported that 71% of the homeless in San Francisco used to be housed there. Losing their homes makes them vulnerable to a host of conditions, some of them deadly. Gentrification can be fatal. It also brings white newcomers to neighborhoods with non-white populations, sometimes with appalling consequences. Local newspaper The East Bay Express recently reported that in Oakland, recently arrived white people sometimes regard people of color who are walking, driving, hanging out, or living in the neighborhood as criminal suspects. Some use the website nextdoor.com to post comments labeling black people as suspects simply for walking down the street, driving a car, or knocking on a door. The same thing happens in the Mission, where people post things on Nextdoor such as, "I called the police a few times when is more than three kids standing like soldiers on the corner." Chat with one another about homeless people as dangers who need to be removed, and justify police killings others see as criminal. What's clear in the case of Nieto's death is that a series of white men perceived him as more dangerous than he was, and that he died from it. On March 1, 2016, the day the trial began, hundreds of students at San Francisco Public Schools walked out of class to protest Nieto's killing. A big demonstration was held in front of the federal courthouse, with drummers, Aztec dancers in feathered regalia, people holding signs, and a TV station interviewing Nieto's friend Benjamin Bach Sierra. Nieto's face on posters, banners, T-shirts, and murals had become a familiar sight in the mission. A few videos about the case had been made. Demonstrations and memorials had been held. For some, Nieto stood for victims of police brutality and for a Latino community that felt imperiled by gentrification, by the wave of evictions and the people who regarded them as menaces and intruders in their own neighborhood. Many people who cared about the Nietos came to the trial each day, and the courtroom was usually nearly full. Trials are theater, and this one had its dramas. A Dante Pointer, a black lawyer with the Oakland firm of John Burris, which handles a lot of local police killing lawsuits, represented Refugio and Elvira Nieto, the plaintiffs. Their star witness, Antonio Theodore, had come forward months after the killing. Theodore is an immigrant from Trinidad, a musician in the band Afrolicious, and a resident of the Bernal area. An elegant man with neat shoulder-length dreads who came to court in a suit, he said he had been on a trail above the road, walking a dog, and that he had seen the whole series of events unfold. He testified that Nieto's hands were in his pockets, that he had not pointed his taser at the officers. There was no red laser light. The officers had just shouted, "Stop," and then opened fire. When Pointer asked him why he had not come forward earlier, he replied, "Just think, it would be hard to tell an officer that I just saw fellow officers shooting up somebody. I didn't trust the police." Theodore testified cogently under questioning from Pointer. But the next morning, when City Attorney Margaret Baumgartner, an imposing white woman with a resentful air, questioned him, he fell apart. He contradicted his earlier testimony about where he had been and where the shooting took place, then declared that he was an alcoholic with memory problems. He seemed to be trying to make himself safe by making himself useless. Pointer questioned him again, and he said, "I don't care to be here right now. I feel threatened." When witnesses are mistrustful or fearful of police, justice is hard to come by, and Theodore seemed terrified of them. The details of what had happened were hotly debated and often contradictory, especially with regard to the taser. The police had testified as though Nieto had been a superhuman or inhuman opponent, facing them off even as they fired into his body again and again, then dropping to a tactical sniper posture on the ground, still holding the taser with its red laser pointing at them. The city lawyers brought in a taser expert whose official testimony seemed to favor them, but when he was asked by Pointer to look at the crime scene photos, he said the taser was off and that it was not something easily or accidentally turned on or off. Was Nieto busy toggling the small on-off switch while also busy having his body hammered by the bullets that killed him on the spot? The light is on only when the taser is on. Officer Morse had testified that when he arrived to kick it out of Nieto's hands, there were no red light or wires coming from it. The taser wires are, however, visible in the police photographs documenting the scene. The taser expert told the court that Nieto's taser's internal record said the trigger had been pulled 3 times. The taser's internal clock said these trigger pulls had happened on March 22nd, after Nieto was dead. The expert witness also said it was set to Greenwich Mean Time and recalculated the time to place these trigger pulls at 7:14 p.m. the night he died. The police didn't have contact with him until 7:17 p.m. The taser expert then created a new theory of clock drift, under which Nieto's taser fired at exactly the right time to corroborate the police version that the taser was on and used at the time they shot him. Even if the trigger was pulled, it is not evidence that he was pointing the taser at them. When a taser is fired, confetti-like marker tags are ejected. None were found at the scene of the crime. Taser has, incidentally, just negotiated a $2 million contract with the police department. One piece of evidence produced was a fragment of bone found in the pocket of Nieto's jacket. Some thought this proved that his hands had been in his pockets, as Theodore said. Dr. Amy Hart, the city coroner, said in the trial on Friday, March 4th, that there were no photographs of his red 49ers jacket, which must have been full of bullet holes. The following Monday, an expert witness for the city mentioned the photographs of the jacket that the city had supplied him. The jurors were shown photographs of Nieto's hat, which had a bullet hole in it that corresponded to the hole in his temple, and of his broken sunglasses lying next to a puddle of blood. The coroner testified to abrasions on Nieto's face consistent with Nieto wearing glasses. Before this evidence was shown, Officer Richard Schiff had testified under oath that he made eye contact with Nieto and saw his forehead pucker up in a frown. If the dead man had been wearing a hat and dark glasses, then Schiff could not have seen these things. Finally, how could four police officers fire 59 bullets at someone without noticing that he was not firing back? And what are we to make of their reports of muzzle flash from an object incapable of producing muzzle flashes? When Elvira Nieto testified about her devastation at the death of her son, Poynter asked her about her husband's feelings as well. "Objection!" shouted Baumgartner, as though what a wife said about her husband's grief could be disqualified as hearsay. The judge overruled her. At another point, Justin Fritz apologized to the Nietos for the outcome of his 911 call and seemed distressed. Refugio Nieto allowed Fritz to hug him. His wife did not. Refugio later said that at that moment he was reminded of Alex's words. "Adriana told me that even with the people that we have conflict with, we need to take the higher ground and show the best of ourselves." Adriana sat with the Nietos every day of the trial, translating for them when the court-appointed translator was off duty. Bach Sierra, in an impeccable suit and tie, was right behind them every day in the first of three rows of benches usually full of friends and supporters. Nieto's uncle often attended, as did Eli Flores, another young Latino who was Nieto's best friend and a fellow Buddhist. Flores later told me that he and Alex had been friends who tried to support each other in living up to their vows and ideals. He said that they wanted to be pure lotuses in their communities, a reference to the key Buddhist phrase about being a pure lotus in muddy water, something spiritual that arises from the messiness of everyday life. Flores had been studying to be a police officer at City College, seeing this as the way he could be of service to his community. But when Nieto was killed, he told me he realized he could never wear a badge or carry a gun. He abandoned the career he'd worked toward for years and started over, training in a culinary academy as a chef. He suggested that Nieto didn't see the police as adversaries and thought that he might instead not have understood that they were coming for him when he walked around the bend in the road that evening, not acted according to the rules for men who are considered suspects and menaces in everyday life. It was a civil trial, so the standard was not beyond a reasonable doubt, just the preponderance of evidence. No one was facing prison, but if the city and officers were found liable, there could be a large financial settlement, and it could affect the careers of the policemen. The trial was covered by many journalists from local TV stations and newspapers. On Thursday, March 10th, 2016, after an afternoon and morning of deliberations, the eight jurors, five white, one Asian woman, and two Asian men, none black, none Latino, unanimously ruled in favor of the police on all counts. Flores wept in the hallway. The American Civil Liberties Union of Northern California published a response to the verdict headlined, "Would Alex Nieto still be alive if he were white?" Police are now investigating claims that Officer Morse posted a sneering attack on Nieto on a friend's Facebook page that night. San Francisco is now a cruel place and a divided one. A month before the trial, the city's mayor, Ed Lee, decided to sweep the homeless off the streets for the Super Bowl, even though the game was played 40 miles away at the new 49ers stadium in Silicon Valley. Online rants about the city's homeless population have become symptomatic of the city's culture clash. The open letter to the mayor, published in mid-February by Justin Keller, founder of a not-very-successful startup, was typical in tone.
I know people are frustrated about gentrification happening in the city, but the reality is we live in a free market society. The wealthy working people have earned their right to live in the city. They went out, got an education, worked hard, and earned it. I shouldn't have to worry about being accosted. I shouldn't have to see the pain, struggle, and despair of homeless people to and from my way to work every day. And, like Evan Snow, who wanted to blow away Alejandro Nieto after their encounter, Keller got his wish in a way. Pushed out of other areas, hundreds of homeless people began to set up tents under the freeway overpass around Division Street, on the edge of the Mission, a gritty industrial area with few residences. The mayor destroyed this rainy season refuge, too. City workers threw tents and belongings into dump trucks and hounded the newly propertyless onward. One of the purges came before dawn the morning the Nieto trial began. When the trial ended with a verdict in favor of the police, 150 or so people gathered inside at the Mission Cultural Center and outside on rainy Mission Street. People were composed, resolute, disappointed, but far from shocked. It was clear that most of them had never counted on validation from the legal system that what happened to Alex Nieto was wrong. Their sense of principle and history was not going to be swayed by this verdict, even if they were saddened or angered by it. Buck Sierra, out of his courtroom suits and in a t-shirt and cap, spoke passionately, as did Oscar Salinas, who had just posted on Facebook the words, "Alex, you will never be forgotten. Your parents will always be taken care of by us, the community. As I've always said, the unspoken word of La Mission is when someone is hurting, needs help, or passes, we come together as a family and take care of them." The Nietos spoke, with Adriana translating for those who did not understand Spanish. And Adriana spoke on her own behalf. "One of the most important changes in my path being involved in the Alex Nieto case has been to learn more about restorative practices, because as someone trained in legal systems, I know that the pain and fear that we are not safe from police and our communities will not go away until there is personal accountability by those who harm us." Adriana, her historian husband, and their friends, including an AIDS activist and a queer choreographer, who live nearby in a ramshackle old building, had faced their own eviction battle last year and won it. But the community that came together that night was still vulnerable to the economic forces tearing the city apart. Many of these people have to move on soon. Some already have. The death of Alex Nieto is a story of one young man torn apart by bullets and of a community coming together to remember him. They pursued more than justice as the case became a cause, as the expressions became an artistic outpouring in videos, posters, and memorials, and as friendships and alliances were forged and strengthened. On April 7th, less than a month after the trial, the police shot longtime San Franciscan Luis Gongora to death, claiming he was rushing them with a knife. Eyewitnesses from the little homeless community he was part of and from surrounding buildings and a security video suggested otherwise. People became angrier about the police they saw as part of a city government wiping out the Black and Latino communities. After the verdict and the killing of Gongora, five people went on a hunger strike in front of the Mission police station, fasting for 18 days in their Hunger for Justice campaign to force the police chief to resign. Conventional wisdom dismissed their perspective and their effort, but on the afternoon of the day that police killed an unarmed mother, Jessica Nelson Williams, in her 20s, the police chief was forced to resign. At the demonstration that night, at the industrial site where Williams died of a single bullet, two women held a banner that said, "We are the last 3%. The Black population had plummeted since its peak in the mid-teens 30 years earlier. Down the block, tucked under a freeway overpass, gentrifying homes were visible, styled in what you could call fortress modernism. That night in March, in the gathering for the anniversary of Nieto's killing, Adriana Camarena told the crowd, "Our victory, as the Nietos said yesterday, is that we are still together." That, too, is a fragile and insecure condition.
I'm sick of pretending to give a shit about what white people think. On the best days, I don't remember their skin, the kingdom and doom of it, their coy relationship to sunlight. Band-aids are the color of the ones who make the wound. And what's a band-aid to a bullet to the rent is sky high and we gotta move? I have no desire to desire what they apparently have. I want quiet and peace and enough weed to last through Saturday. So now that we're done talking about them, do you think it's appropriate to call that nigga Obama a nigga in public? I have accepted that they, who is always they, will always be looking, so what's the use in holding back my black cackling juke? What's the purpose in being black if you have to spend it trying to prove all the ways you're not? I'm done with race. Could you imagine if it was that easy? To just say, I'm done, and all the scars turn into ravens, the trees forget their blood memory, and the city lose all its teeth? When people say they're post-race, I think they're saying they're done with black people, done with immigrants, officially believing America began when the white people demanded their freedom from the other white people. I'm post-America in that case. I'm so far in the future, I'm on the beaches of Illinois' southern coast of a has-been empire, telling my grandkids about the dust that used to rule us. Denise Smith.
Notes of a Native Daughter, Sandra Cisneros. How to explain, Chicago, why you and me split. Nelson Algren dubbed you a woman with a broken nose, albeit a lovely one, but you are guilty of breaking more than noses. Gwendolyn Brooks painted you as grayed in and gray. And this is how I remember your bruised skies of October, November, December, January, February, March, April, till May. Lorraine Hansberry fumigated your cockroaches. Richard Wright stalked your rats. Studs Terkel quoted a Chicagoan who said, I always feel a chest swelling when I drive along the lake. Yet I know four blocks over is desperation. So much desperation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.